Christmas Eve service next Sunday evening, as well as church that morning. So hopefully you can make it to both of those. It's a really special tradition that we've developed here, coming together at Christmas Eve that evening, and it's going to be good this year. It's going to be special. Hope that you can make that. Well, welcome. We're glad you're here today. We're glad you're joining us online. Thank you so much for choosing that the Lord is the most important thing for you this day, to be here this morning. And let's go to him in prayer and give thanks for his graciousness to us. Our Lord and our God, you are just that. You're so gracious. You're so good. You're so kind. You're so loving. You're so forgiving. You're so merciful. Lord, all of these things we give you praise for and more. You are wonderful, Lord. Father, we gather together today to focus upon Jesus and what he did for us on the cross. And Father, may this be the beginning of the week where we focus everything upon Jesus and view everything through that lens of the cross. And we've been redeemed. We've been purchased by the blood of Christ. May we live like people who have been redeemed. Bring you honor and glory all the days of our lives. Father, may we be a blessing to you today. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's continue singing. Lived a sinless life and died on the cross for us. Praise the Lord again.
Emmanuel, his name is God.
We're going to sing another one in just a minute, but before that, we're going to partake of the Lord's Supper together. Peace on earth. Someone once said that true peace is not the absence of conflict, but it's the presence of God no matter what the conflict. Would you agree?
Amen.
Jesus told us in this world we'd have many troubles. There's always wars and rumors of wars, and right now it seems like to you, maybe our world is coming apart. We see acts of depravity daily. We see lawlessness. We see things that just defy common sense and certainly defy God's holiness. But yet in that song it says, God is not dead, nor does he sleep. That is true. That is true, and the bells still peel, peace on earth, goodwill to men and women upon whom his favor rests. It is true. There is peace on earth. If you're in Christ, you know that peace on earth, no matter what the conflict around you. And that's because of what Christ did on the cross. You see, he defeated all your enemies, your ultimate enemies, sin and death and hell and the grave. He stomped them. In fact, that's probably a good word to use, because it tells us all the way back in Genesis that the serpent would bruise his heel, but Christ would crush his head. And he did it right up there. For you. For me. Let's focus on that which brings us peace, the cross of Jesus Christ, the love of God manifested for mankind. And let's come back for a new week and get our focus as we partake. Let's pray. Father, we give you thanks for the day that is today. We thank you, Father, for this being a day that we have been resurrected by the blood of Jesus Christ. We're no longer dead in our sin. Father, help us to forsake them, put them in the rearview mirror, and never look back. Father, may we bring you glory and honor and praise. May we declare that there is peace on earth, and that God's goodwill is still available for men and women, boys and girls, and whosoever will can come. Know the salvation of Jesus, which we give you thanks right now. We ask your blessing upon the loaf and the cup, the symbols of Christ's body and blood, broken and spilled out for us. Thank you, Father, for the sacrifice of Jesus. May we share the good news with all around till he comes again. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
Let's partake.
This day, if so, would you say amen?
Amen.
Would you stand with me? The children have already left, but would you stand with me? Would you greet someone around you and wish them a Merry Christmas and welcome them to warm and
Merry Christmas.
You know my son.
Merry Christmas.
We're here today. We need a kind of fellowship in the Christmas season. We do want to welcome all the college students. students to our home this weekend. We're glad you're here. There's a big lesson today about being patient and waiting and working at God. We've got some events yet this week, month, I should say. Next Sunday is Christmas Eve. If you're not aware, we have a 10 o'clock worship, and then we have a 7 p.m. gathering at night, a traditional 45 minutes of Christmas singing, Bible reading story for children, a candlelight service, communion service, the whole day. Come both services if you can. Let's celebrate Christ's birth. And then the last Sunday of the year is New Year's Eve. Let's have a party here. And the reason we're having a party is because the preacher isn't going to preach. I have a nephew. He looks like me. He's going to preach. Ryan Mabel is going to be here. He's an associate minister down in Sarasota, Florida. He's got family here in town. And I'm looking forward to hearing him preach. He's 34 years of age now. And he's going to do a good job on the last Sunday of the year. And then on the first Sunday of the new year, we will launch a study for 13 weeks on Revelations, the book of Revelations.
Oh my.
Now, it is 22 chapters. We're going to compress them into 13 weeks. So that means you need to get your Bibles. You need to read how the story of end times is going to end and how we're going to have victory in Christ. Be patient on God. He's working toward that end. My first thought here is you get to Ruth chapter 4, which is 3, I should say, is have you ever noticed that desperate situations often call for desperate measures? And there are a couple widows who are desperate for a better future. Might kind of be like a woman in West Texas who went to see the governor to beg for her husband's release from prison. And after a long wait, she was ushered into the governor's office and proceeded to tell why she needed her husband home. And the governor asked, "What's he in for?" And the woman said, he got put in prison for stealing pants. "Well, that doesn't sound too bad," said the governor. "Was he a good husband?" And she replied, "As a matter of fact, no, he never said a kind word in all the years that we've been married." The governor kind of looked back and said, "Was he a good worker?" And "No, he was pretty lazy. I can't remember him ever having a steady job." The governor asked again, "Well, was he a good father to the kids?" And she said, "Well, to tell the truth, he was pretty mean to the kids. Never paid attention to them unless he was drunk, and then he'd yell and be mean to them then." "Ma'am," said the governor, I have to ask you, why do you want a man like him out of prison?" And she replied, "Well, governor, we need some help." What does that have to do with anything today? Ruth 1 and 2, Naomi and Ruth are broken widows struggling on their own. They're hungry widows. They have been gleaning in the fields from the leftovers that the harvesters missed. The harvest is nearly over. They're living on those leftovers. They're desperate for a better future. They need someone to provide them some ham, beans, and cornbread. Now, probably not ham, they're Jewish people, but you get the idea. They need something. And in Ruth 3, we see a godly plan to get God moving, to get a man into their life. There's an old saying, pain is inevitable, misery is optional. I suspect in this audience, there are some of you in this joyful Christmas season, you have a pain that is just digging into your insides, your soul. And it's true, it's going to happen, but misery is optional. Will you trust God to bring a solution? Well, that's the story of Ruth 3. And it takes Naomi's plan, it takes Ruth's plan, and it takes Boaz's plan for God to use. And I want you to see first here in chapter 3 that Naomi had a plan. The oldest of the two widows, the mother-in-law, had a plan. And love requires expression. Now, from the outset of creation, when God looked at the world, there was only one bad thing in all the things he had created up to that point. And God said, it is not good that the man should be alone. I need to make a helper suitable for him. And voila, God created Eve and brought Eve to the man. Now, it's equally true that it is not good for a woman to be alone. And we at River Valley have several widows and several who live singularly who probably agree with that. Any amens on that?
Amen.
Not good to be alone. We all need someone to share life with and to pour into, or we just bottle things up and we become a terrible mess. A classic example of what happens when you don't release what God has given to you in an unnourished soul is possibly demonstrated best when you know the geography of Israel and know that in that land of Israel today, that at the part of northern Israel is the Sea of Galilee, where Jesus did many mighty works. And then the Jordan River drains out of it to the south into a body of water that is called the Dead Sea. And what you see at the Sea of Galilee, even today, you've got commercial fishing. It takes in water from different sources, and it gets out into the Jordan River, and then it drains down into the Dead Sea, and the Dead Sea is there, and it's stagnant. It's backed up. It's void of life. It doesn't even have fish that can live there. And the only way to get out of that body of water is you have to evaporate. And so what's left is you have an image that when you receive, you need to give. You need to give. You need to let it out. You need to have a friend. And I'm sure some of you believe that today. It is just a principle of life that the impression that you get in all the things you do needs to be expressed properly, or it leads to depression. Well, for Naomi and Ruth, they're a little backed up in little old Bethlehem. They have each other, but these two widows need more than leftover grain. They need property secured. They need children around the home. They need a provider, and they need a future. And so in Ruth 1, we know they believe there's a God, but they have to wait on him. Remember Ruth 1:6, Naomi heard in Moab that the Lord had come to the aid of his people, providing food for them, and she and her daughter-in-law prepared to return home. We know they believe God stopped the famine. And now they're back in the land. In Ruth 3:1-3, we know they believe God is at work with another provision that is called the kinsman redeemer. And she, Naomi, who was raised in Israel, knows that's the best option for our future. We need to tap in to what God has as an idea for some to move forward. So, look at verse 1. One day, Ruth's mother-in-law, Naomi, said to her, "My daughter, I must find a home for you where you will be provided for well." And so Naomi, this more seasoned widow, says to the younger widow, "I've got some concern for you. I'm concerned about your future." And her concern for Ruth's well-being is expressed. And love allows that kind of expression. Philippians 2:4 says, "Look each of you not only to your own interests, but to the interests of others." And that's what the church is taught to do. But how often is it done in the home? Wouldn't our world be better if every family would put into practice, look not only to your own interests, but to the interests of others? Too often in a household, we live by the standard of what's in it for me, rather than look at the situations and say, what good can I do with you, for you, that you might have a better day? And Naomi's love required expressing to Ruth this plan that God had for his people. Plus, if you think about it, doesn't an older lady like to play matchmaker for the younger ladies in their circle? And so there's a potential solution expressed in verse 2. Now Boaz, who with women you have worked, is a relative of ours. Tonight he will be winnowing barley on the threshing floor. I know, good heart, hard-working man. You've already met him. I'm going to work to see you two get together. Naomi doesn't detail the concept that rests in the kinsman redeemer, but she clearly knows it exists and that it is an honorable plan in place by God. And so she begins to set in motion this plan and expresses her love that here's a way for you to be united. And I think down deep inside, Naomi believes the truth of that old song we used to sing, it only takes a spark to get a fire going. And she's trying to let the spark. And so an appeal to act is expressed by Naomi. And Ruth is coached by Naomi to do four things. Look at what the coaching of setting up someone is. You ought to be attractive, number one. Clean up. Wash yourself. Smell up. Put on perfume. Dress up. Get clothes. Get dressed in your best clothes. That's what was the first piece of advice. Be attractive. Now, that last little instruction, get dressed in your best clothes, was probably because ever since they had become widows, they might have been wearing widow's garments. And Naomi's encouraging Ruth, get some fresh clothes on. Let's not live in the past. We're going to begin to prepare for the future. You dress up good for your man. And I think that's good counsel that ought to be given as courtship is about to begin. Now, though the goal is to be attractive, I want to also say I understand love ought not be based on something as shallow as appearance. It ought to be deeper than that. But I want you to know that even the godliest man enjoys a woman who has put effort into looking and smelling good. So be attractive. And then two, here's the next advice. Be attentive. Look at the instruction. Then go down to the threshing floor. Don't let him know you are there until he has finished eating and drinking. And when he lies down, note the place where he is lying. Wait till he goes to sleep before you act. And he's going to be tired. He's been working all day. They've been threshing the grain. They're trying to get a product that can be turned into food to eat. He's going to be tired. Pay attention to where he's sleeping. Now, some people said he would be sleeping at the end of the grain pile because he was protecting the harvest from thieves who might be nearby. And so you know where he's giving himself some rest. And then the instruction is, be a little assertive. Be assertive. Look what it says. Then go and uncover his feet and lie down. Now, I want you to know Ruth is not telling her to make a sexual advance. She's just saying, go, take his cover, take it off his feet, and lie down near him. I don't know about you, but when the blankets come off my feet, I tend to wake up pretty shortly thereafter. And so, when you wake up, there you'll be. He's a grown man. He's going to wake up, but he's also a God. And then the fourth instruction is, be available. She was told he will tell you what to do. And so the communication between two in courtship is based on communication. Be available. Be listening. Be ready to listen and be ready to respond. And as I studied for this sermon, I was thinking, well, this is a plan for Naomi. it does have an awareness of God having a way in the world to move forward. John Piper calls this strategic righteousness. God may be in charge, but you need to take some action. He is teaching that we should behave righteously in every relationship. We should maintain a zeal for purity. We need to guard our passions. But we need to combine faithfulness with a strategy of intention and purpose and planning. And that often happens as you go through romance and courtship and eventually to marriage. Now, nowhere does Naomi insinuate that Ruth is to be seductive to latch on to Boaz. And I don't think anyone should sleep their way to the top. But Naomi's instruction is a good plan for that day and has some validity for a standard of operation even today. Now, quickly, you're going to have to determine, what am I going to do with this instruction from the older seasoned woman? What's she teaching, what God would have her to do? And Ruth came to the conclusion, yes. So Ruth's plan is going to hear Naomi's instruction, and she's going to act in faith because faith requires action. You see, whenever you meet and you collaborate, any football team that has ever won a Super Bowl, it's not won by staying in the huddle of collaboration. Every team has to break the huddle. Every team has to have a play. Every team has to execute that play. That play calling and implementing brings the victory. How does Ruth respond to Naomi's coaching? Well, she could have said to Naomi, I'm tired. I don't feel like it. That isn't for me. I don't want to do it that way. Or favorite of some people is, you're not the boss of me. You can't tell me what to do. But if you think you can just do nothing and still get ahead in life, you're often sadly mistaken. If you always do what you've always done, you're probably always going to get what you always got. And what do they call that? Insanity. So the greatest risk is to decide to do nothing. And there's an epitaph on one tombstone that is, I think, the result of somebody's inaction. Here lies the body of Lester Lee underground. He couldn't decide which side of the tree to ski around. So indecision is a decision, and the indecision can be costly. We've got a lot of decisions to make in life. You know, God commands the church, go into all the world and make disciples. Will we or won't we? Hudson Taylor, founder of China Inland Mission, says, unless there is an element of risk in our exploits for God, there is no need for faith. Well, their situation was desperate. God had a solution out there, which Ruth walked through it as Naomi taught. What would Ruth do? And I see a decision to obey got Ruth going. Look at verse 5. I will do whatever you say. Wow. Surrendering to the instruction that God might meet their need. Faith is always walking for God. It's not just talking about Him. You need to do some walking and talking. Verse 6. So she went down to the threshing floor. That's where he had been working. Did everything her mother-in-law told her to do. Verse 7. When Boaz had finished eating and drinking, he was in good spirits. He went over to lie down at the far end of the grain pile. And Ruth approached him quietly, uncovered his feet, and lay down. And so she took a risk. You see, God will grant us opportunity to improve our situation, but we need to show by faith our attitude and our actions are righteous as well. Ruth took a risk. If you have a problem here today, will you take a risk? Will you act righteously? True heroes take initiative. They do the right thing, even though it does include a risk. William Carey, the father of modern missions, lived by this faith statement. Expect great things from God. Attempt great things for God. And by just watching Boaz, watching where he slept, and going there and uncovering his feet and lying next to him was a big thing for Ruth to do. Her decision to obey was just to go sleep at Boaz's feet. But Ruth 3 shows that God honors the heart that is set on attempting great things for God and his kingdom. Look at what it says in verse 8. In the middle of the night, something startled the man. He turned and there was a woman lying at his feet, and he said, "Who are you?" And this was for Boaz a rude awakening. That rude awakening, the blanket off his feet, woke him up, and he's got a woman at the bottom of his bed. Life is sometimes filled with rude awakenings. Have you ever been woken suddenly in the middle of the night? I read of a newspaper story of a man whose bedroom was in a home that was on a curve of a road that went by the house. He had a rude awakening one night when a drunk drove through the railing, through the bedroom wall, and halfway into his bed, and the car stopped just 2 feet from his bed. That would be a rude awakening. Sometimes rude awakenings are pleasant. Sometimes they're unpleasant. In Genesis 2, Adam awoke from a deep sleep and discovered that God had taken a rip from his sight. But the good thing was he made a woman and brought him together with the woman. That was good. Genesis 29, Jacob woke up, discovered he was married to the wrong wife. Yes. Remember that rude awakening? He had worked 7 years for Rachel. They had a wedding. And then in the middle of the night, Laban switched the oldest daughter with the youngest daughter. And when Jacob woke up, he had the wrong wife. I've never quite figured out that one. That tent must have been really dark. And then maybe because they were living in the times of judges, did Ruth and Boaz know about Samson the judge? He awoke from his sleep after his interactions with Delilah. And when he woke up, he couldn't break the bonds of which he was tied with. He had lost his strength because Delilah had betrayed him. Rude awakening, was it going to be pleasant? Was it going to be unpleasant? But one thing was certain. Boaz was fully asleep because he's asleep to the point when his feet are uncovered, he doesn't notice a woman who is bathed and perfumed and cuddling at his feet. But something started. Who are you? And when he gathered his wits, after he asked, "Who are you?" look what she answered. She answered, "I am your servant, Ruth." Humbly. And then she made a bold request. "Spread the corner of your garment over me, since you are my guardian redeemer of our family." Again, that wasn't a call to seductive behavior. To spread the blanket over her, or to spread the garment over her, was asking him to put the wing of his protection over her. Ruth made a humble proposal to get their joint venture of kinsman redeemer going. Ruth's proposal was risky. And yet, do you understand the nature of risk? Wayne Gretzky says you'll always miss 100% of the shots you never take. She tried. She tried it Naomi's way, and it looks like it was God. But do you understand the risk of this request? Here was a servant asking her boss to marry her. This was a Moabite making a request of an Israelite. This was a woman proposing to a man. It was a poor young lady asking a richer, older man that they might be united. Was this an act of foreign naivety? Or was it a daughter-in-law's devotion to a mother-in-law? Or was it a way God was going to use to bring one man and one woman together? You see, from a natural perspective, the scheme was doomed from the beginning as a hopeless gamble. But with righteous strategy, Naomi placed Ruth in a reasonable position that God could work. But Ruth took a risk. And imagine when she offered this proposal, how long did Boaz wait to answer? Don't you suspect the hearts were pounding in the moments of silence between Ruth's act of faith and her words and waiting for Boaz to make a plan? Would he be gracious or would he be harsh? Well, look at Boaz's plan. He's a man of honor. And he's about to, with that honor, require commitment of himself. The lesson that we're going to end with today is, don't take shortcuts in your romance. Boaz, he makes a gracious response. Look at verse 16. The Lord bless you, my daughter. This kindness is greater than that which you showed me earlier. And you have not run after the younger man, which, whether be rich or poor. Boaz was surprised by her presence, but his first response was gracious. The Lord bless you, my daughter. But when he surveyed the situation and the proposal, it kind of bugged him. Why me? Why not some younger, richer me? You probably heard the story of the young man who kneeled before a beautiful young lady and said, "Darling, darling, I want you to know I love you more than life. I want you to marry me, but I'm not a wealthy man. I don't have a yacht, a Rolls Royce. I don't have a lot of money like Johnny Green, but I do love you with all my heart." And the young lady heard that tender moment, and she replied, "Darling, I love you with all my heart too. But before I say yes, could you tell me more about little Johnny Green?" Well, Boaz's character as a knight in shining armor is honorable. He compliments her. He thinks to himself, "Why does a fair young lady want an old fuddy-dud like me?" And then he quickly calms her fears. He recognizes her as a daughter. Look at what he says in 11. "Now, my daughter, don't be afraid. I will do for you all you ask. All the people of my town know that you are a woman of noble character." Now, two thoughts in this tender moment and exchange. The first thought is that Boaz recognized she was taking a bold position. She was praising, he was praising her courage. "Don't be afraid." Are you aware that the term "fear not," which the shepherds gave, got from the angels, "Fear not, to bring to you tidings of great joy." That phrase, "fear not," appears, or "do not be afraid," appears 365 times in the Bible. Some people say you have a comfort from God to not fear in your life situations every day. God's man encouraged this woman to fear not. But he also recognized Ruth's love and loyalty, and that even the whole town knew it was legendary. He called her a woman of noble character, and that's the exact phrase in the final chapter of Proverbs that asks this question: who can find a wife of noble character? And he's about to find one of that nature. And so Boaz calms the fears. He expresses his commitment to be the kinsman redeemer. But just before we are ready to rejoice and hear a story with a happy ending, there's a little snag in this process, in this plan that even God endorses. Boaz gives an honest assessment in verse 12. Although it is true that I am a guardian redeemer of our family, there is another who is more closely related than I. Stay here for the night, and in the morning, if he wants to do his duty as your guardian redeemer, good. I'll let him redeem you. And what the guideline in Israel was, typically the primary guardian redeemer was a brother of the widow's family. The husband who died, the brother became this redeemer. There was no brother in Naomi's home, no son of Naomi. But it might be that Boaz was a cousin, and closer than being a cousin may have been an uncle of Naomi's husband, Elimelech. And so, honoring the law of the land, he says, I will be your guardian redeemer, but I'm not the closest one who is qualified. There is someone closer than me. But if he will not, he spoke this commitment. If he's not willing, as sure as the Lord lives, I will do it. Lie here with me till the morning. And his character shines through when he says, lie with me here till the morning. Now, he's not asking them to be an intimate relationship at that point. He is protecting her at that grain pile. He's saying, before you go back home, and I want you to do that discreetly, stay here until the morning comes, and even the thieves will not take advantage of you. His impulse was not to be unwise. His impulse was not to act indecently, but instead to protect and provide order for her life. He doesn't walk away from the commitment. He initiates a sequence of patience. Look at verse 14. So she lay down at his feet until morning, but before anyone could recognize her. And he said, no one must know that a woman came to the threshing floor. There was a decency that needed to be in this moment. Stay until daylight. When the daylight comes, God will protect you on the way home. At the same time, this is an example of righteous restraint. If we were putting this story into action in our world today, when the commitment to get married would have been made between the two, in the middle of the night, the TV show or made-for-movie story today, we probably launch this couple into a passionate, intimate love scene. And few adults or teenagers delay intimacy for marriage. Lots of people believe if two people are in love, it is not realistic at all to practice abstinence or to be sexually inactive. A senator in Washington once said, today's teens are just hormone hurricanes, and you can't stop a hurricane. But I want you to know, if you're in the middle of courtship today, there's a greater force than the hurricane. There's the creator of that hurricane. Always honor him. And for people who are in distress, broken, hurting, looking for a future, the hardest part of life is sitting still and waiting for God to make a way. Because he does work things out for the good of those who love him and who are called according to his purpose. Amen?
Amen.
Taking shortcuts in the area of intimacy before waiting on God and his working for good, it is troublesome to best illustrate somebody launching out on their own to try to do what God promises in our life to be fruitful and multiply. Abraham took Hagar and fathered a child before the child that God really desired would come through Sarah. And that hasty decision of Abraham to act before God acted has been costly even to our world today. God will give his best to those who wait on him. That's part of the story here in Ruth. While Boaz and Ruth practiced patience, Boaz then offered Ruth a generous provision. Look what he did. He said, "Bring me your shawl that you're wearing and hold it out." And when he did, he poured into it 6 measures of barley and placed the bundle on her, then went back to town. She came to her mother-in-law, Naomi. "How did it go, my daughter?" And then she told her everything Boaz had done for her. And it was easy to talk to the mother-in-law about the relationship. Nothing to hide. "And he gave me these 6 measures of barley, saying, don't go back to your mother-in-law empty-handed." Wow. What a good character Boaz is. Ruth must have been wearing some kind of a cape, a scarf, a shawl. And he said, "Take that off. We're at the threshing floor where the grain is ready." And he has that garment held out. She holds out the garment like a sack. And Boaz pours into that shawl 6 measures of barley. Don't know how much that is. But you can see he is committing to her. And people don't doubt what you say. They always believe what you do. She believes he's going to come through for me. And all he's doing is showing, I am an honorable man. And then patience continues. The story ends with Naomi saying, "Wait, my daughter, until you find out what happens, for the man will not rest until the matter is settled today." Again, they gotta wait. They must be patient. But sometimes the best thing God has for you comes to you as you wait. Be still. Wait on the Lord to act. Something good is going to happen. I like what I read from Charles Swindoll. God wants all of us in our stage of waiting. Don't run. Don't escape. Don't give up. Let your faith run its course, that you might know how good God is.
Amen.
When he acts in his timing, you are blessed with strategic righteousness. You'll have peace with God and those around you. And you won't have to undo the tangled messes that we often get our own selves into. Are you waiting in your storm? The story of Ruth says, wait, be patient, but God is working on your behalf. Would you stand with me right now? I'm going to close with this last. I think the entire story is talking to a desperate, broken world. And I don't know about you, but I think we're living in one. It tells a story that broken women, broken men need to wait on God. There's a story I've read a couple times on Facebook. You may have read it. It's about a fellow going through this season of year, this Christmas season, and he's going through some tough times, and he just happens to be visiting a Dollar Tree store. He doesn't understand why it's so hard this time of year to be dealing with life. And he said, I was in Dollar Tree last night. There was a lady with two kids behind me in the long line. One was a big kid. One was a toddler. The bigger one had a pack of glow sticks, and the baby was screaming for them. So the mom opened the pack, gave him one, and he was waving it around, and it pacified him as it was for just a while. And then the older brother took it from him. And the older brother broke the glow stick, and then he handed it back to the younger brother. And of course, the stick began to glow, and the child began to appreciate that stick all the more. And the mother was about to reprimand the older brother, but he explained, here's what he did. He didn't understand I had to break it so the full effect from that stick would come. The glow happens after you've been broken. And the fellow was watching that exchange, and he was looking at the trouble in his own life, and he says, maybe that's God's message for me today. God can use me even though I'm broken. Maybe he's got to break me and let the glow come afterwards that I might appreciate the gift he's given me. And that kind of matches what it says in 1 Peter. Though for a little while you may have to suffer grief and all kinds of trials, these have come so that your faith is proven genuine. And it be of greater worth than gold. It's going to glow. Whatever is happening may result in praise and glory and honor when Jesus is revealed. You may not see it now, but there's going to be a day. The glow will be there, and God will be honored as you have worked through with his help. And so some people have, they can go through life kind of content. But then they get broken, we get sick, we lose a job, we go through a divorce, we face an addiction. And worst of all, we bury a spouse or a son or a daughter. And we think, where is God? But he can make a goal happen. I just left the house this morning. And on Fox News, there was a couple who knew before the pregnancy was going to happen that the baby was going to have an anomaly, and they were encouraged to go through with abortion. And they said, no, we're not going to shortcut the pain. They went against doctor's advice. They gave birth to the child. They took the child from the hospital to the home. But the child only lived 15 days. But they said every one of those days were precious, where they got memories. And yes, they let God lead, not take a shortcut. And they surrendered that child to the Lord when God called. They have since started a ministry to advocate to parents who are faced with challenges before birth. And they're challenging people. They are people of God. Trust God when you hurt. And that would be my challenge to you. When you're hurting, don't turn your back on God. Embrace God. Trust him. You practice strategic righteousness. And let him work in your life. And in his time, he'll make all things better. For those who love him, who are called according to his purpose. You'll have a new glow, maybe a new ministry you never realized you'd ever have. But we read in chapter 4, the glow is about to happen, the marriage is about to happen, and a child is about to be born. Would you just wait on the final chapter of your life to be written? A glow is coming your way. Maybe today you need to accept Christ as Lord. Trust him. He's a child that came from that child in chapter 4 of Ruth. Jesus, today the Savior has been born. He's Christ the Lord. Is he your Christ? Is he your Messiah? Is he your hope? Would you express your faith? Would you take some action? The Bible says repent and be baptized every one. Confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord. Believe in your heart God raised him from the dead. You'll be saved. We ask you, would you hear, believe, repent, confess, be baptized? Would you claim Christ as Lord?
Take an action of faith. Let God lead. And let Him be patient in your work. Sure, there are others. It is great to see Pam Reed here. Would you welcome Pam Reed? She tells me that her numbers and her blood count are baffling the doctors. Amen. We're not baffled. We have Amen. A God who will help in such a case like this. God's working for her good because she's called according to the purpose of it. Welcome back. College students, welcome back. Thank you. Blue eyes, gray skies. Would you give them a hand?
Amen.
And thank the good Lord who we worship today. Father, thank you for this day of worship. Thank you for this church family. Thank you for those who love you. I pray for anybody in this circle today who's in the middle of some kind of storm. They just don't see a way out. Would you calm them? Would they see your hand at work? Would they trust you? Would they practice a strategic righteousness? Always doing what's right. Don't take any shortcuts, but trust that God will make a way. Father, thank you for this example for Ruth. May we learn from her. And may we rejoice with the child that's going to be born in chapter 4, because we know that only 31 generations, we celebrate the most famous child who's ever going to be born from Ruth. Father, thank you for Jesus who died for our sins. May we leave here today praising him, serving him everywhere we go. It is in Jesus' name I pray and all the people of God say.
Amen. Facebook family, we got started late this morning. I just have a couple of announcements. December 24th, there's a Christmas Eve service at 7 p.m. as well as church that morning at 10 a.m. December 31st, Ryan Abel is going to preach, and in January, the Hoops League is going to start. So if you've got young people, please get them involved. That is a wonderful program. And lastly, Porch Time is having a bake sale auction on December 17th to help needy families in Morgan County. Baked goods would need to be collected by December 16th. If you can help bake something amazing and let's get that money rolling in, call Kathy Grossclose. She can arrange all of this for you and pick that up and get that to the right people. The number for Kathy is 765-318-4706. You guys have an awesome, wonderful week. And as always, we would love for you to come and worship with us side by side in this building. We are so blessed by worshiping with you. But if you cannot for any reason, please tune in next Sunday. We will be Facebook Live again, and we would love for you to worship with us there. Have a great and awesome week, and be blessed all week long.